Support for this episode has been provided by Ratio Keto-Friendly Dairy Snacks. If counting macros makes your head spin, count instead on a snack by Ratio. They've done the math for you, so you can spend less time studying the label and more time enjoying your day. Creamy and delicious, try strawberry and vanilla for 2 grams of carbs and a unique combination of sugar and protein. Interested? Ratio Keto-Friendly Dairy Snacks are now available in the yogurt aisle at Walmart. Always consult your physician before starting an eating plan that involves regular consumption of high-fat foods.
CVS is your one-stop shop for immunity support and more. This week, select CVS Health and Zicam products are buy one, get one 50% off. Visit CVS or CVS.com today. Restrictions apply. See CVS.com/weeklyad for details.
He's on his way, he's going to Hollywood, he's bussing it to Hollywood. Show him the way, he's moving to Hollywood, he's helping it to Hollywood.
Welcome to Hollywood Hoops. He's Eric Pincus of Basketball Insiders and Bleacher Report. I'm Josh Martin of Close Up 360. You're listening to us wherever you get your podcasts and shows, whether that's Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, Stitcher, Spreaker, lineups.com, or every Wednesday from 9 to 10 a.m. Pacific time on Dash Radio's Nothing But Net channel. Eric, we're coming to the folks here on Tuesday, October 20th. The Dodgers will be starting the World Series tonight in a battle to see which sports city will be crowned the kings of quarantine, whether it's LA, who already have the Lakers as champions in the NBA, or if it's going to be Tampa, which already has the Lightning from the NHL as a champion. It's Dodgers versus Rays. Interesting stuff, but obviously we're more focused here on basketball with the Lakers. And there's been a lot swirling around about their immediate future, potentially long-term future, the roster and who's going to be on it and who might be out. This is all obviously without anything concrete about when the quote-unquote offseason actually starts, when free agency will actually be here, and how this roster maneuvering might look in this uncertain time in the midst of a pandemic. How does this all sort of look to you now? We were seeing a lot of stuff about different players opting out, the Lakers trying to shape their roster and clear some space for whatever might come next. Where do you see the Lakers just from a 30,000-foot view here, coming off a championship and potentially gearing up for what I'm sure they hope will be a successful repeat?
Well, it starts with the notion that we have no information. We only have ideas of what's going to happen with the timing. To put that in perspective, like, everybody's contracts technically should have expired on June 30th. And obviously that didn't happen, and everything was sort of frozen. So we're still frozen. They had opened up a period before the bubble started where you could sign certain players, substitute players. That's how J.R. Smith ended up on the Lakers, that sort of thing. But you still couldn't opt guys in. You couldn't give extensions. You can't waive players. You can't. Anyone who has a contract that was, say, $1 million guaranteed, and on July the 5th, it became fully guaranteed, just making up something. That was pushed back. And all that was pushed back to around October 23rd, but then it was pushed back even further. So it's now officially TBD. There is no date. It doesn't exist. So the teams, all 30 teams, are, essentially planning for a world where they don't know what the salary cap is going to be. And that's always the case to a degree, but you have an estimate from the league. And so the current estimate, based at least on the pre-shutdown, was that next year would be $115 million. So everyone has that projection. So while you don't know until this June 29th, I think it is, you don't really know, or maybe June 30th, you don't know the exact number. It's probably going to be within a million of 115. So maybe it drops to 114.5, or it climbs to 15 million, or 15.5 or whatever. You kind of knew roughly. Right now we have nothing. We don't know. And there's been some discussion that the cap will remain flat. And if it remains flat, 109.5 1 million, that's where the cap would be, and the tax would presumably be about 133 million. So, or it could climb to 115 and just stay what it was supposed to be. And there was, I forget what who Michelle, I think she talked to Shams of The Athletic, Michelle Roberts of The Union. And if I'm wrong, then I apologize. But I think that's where it was sourced, where she said that they should probably stick with that projection. That would be their goal. And so if that's the case, then the teams need to also project for that 115. So they got to project 115, 109, but maybe they need to project that it drops significantly. Maybe they need to project for 100. How do you build a team when you don't know what the cap is going to be? You don't know what the tax is going to be. You don't know who's going to opt in. You don't know who's going to opt out. All of these things would have already happened. So there's just a massive uncertainty. And this applies to the Lakers, the Clippers, and all the 28 other teams. And the other side of that is that you don't know where the tax line is. And I did a stream, Josh. I know we've been talking about it on the show for a few weeks that I was going to stream. I actually did one the other day. And you could see it pinned to my Twitter feed if you want to check it out. I'm at Eric Pincus. It's pinned to my feed. And click the link there. It's a two-hour video. And so you could just put it on in the background, listen to it. And I kind of break down why it matters. But a team like the Lakers or the Nuggets, I use the Nuggets too as an example, they may not be able to use the full mid-level exception, which is the biggest spending tool that you would normally have, roughly $10 million, let's call it. They may not have access to that because they may be using their money to pay KCP to stay, Rondo to pay. And if the tax line's low enough, they're going to have what's called a hard cap. They're going to have a limit to what they can spend, which would be about, call it $139 million in that range. And so there's all these factors that they don't know that could get in the way of them spending money. So we'll get into the scenarios, Josh. I just kind of want to put out there that we're dealing with a big pile of we don't know, no one knows. We're going to know at some point, but we definitely don't know now.
Yeah, and it's quite the environment. Obviously, uncertainty is something that teams at least have maybe had to get used to ever since March. Hopefully, you would think that this being the highest level of professional basketball and whatnot, and the level of organizations that are involved in the NBA, that perhaps there has been an adjustment to that black box. And this is what we're dealing with, is just a total unknown, essentially. But despite that, Eric, we've already seen reports of a number of players from the Lakers who seem to be at least leaning towards opting out of their deals, right? There's been reports of Anthony Davis opting out of his contract, Rajon Rondo opting out of his option year, KCP opting out as well. I know that we had discussed prior to the restart the uncertainty surrounding this and the impact it would have on the cap and whether it would be more prudent for some of these players to, say, opt in, give themselves a little bit of a buffer against that uncertainty, and then re-enter the market in 2021 when perhaps maybe things are more settled down. There's been some recovery in the cap and in the economics of the league. And according to The Athletic, the NBA lost in the ballpark of $700 million from the games that were canceled. And the Lakers topped all teams in those losses at right around $53 million. But I guess if you're a team in the NBA and you're proceeding, or a team or a player, whatever entity in the NBA, and the guiding thought is that the cap isn't going to change, at least that you're working with, and that maybe it's all dealt with on the back end with escrow and whatnot, which is what happened going into the bubble, then I guess that doesn't really affect necessarily what you would do as a player from an economic standpoint. You would take the same strategy that you took, that you would take in a normal year. If you are in a position to opt out and get more money, you would still do that. Does that seem to jive with where things are at right now, like, and why these guys, especially on the Lakers, seem to be leaning towards leaving behind guaranteed money to venture back into the market?
Well, there's the notion that, oh, teams won't have money, so therefore you shouldn't opt out. You should all take the money. And there's some truth to that for certain players, but it's going to be subjective based on each player's situation. So Rondo, KCP, AD cannot opt out right now. They can at some point, but everything's frozen. But what we're getting in these reports is more of they intend to opt out. They will opt out, but they haven't yet because they can't, just based on the stoppage that we're still in. But in the case of, if we're going to talk Lakers, we probably got to go player by player, right? Because everybody's case is different. With Anthony Davis, he is finishing up his eighth season. So he'll have 8 years of service at the end of the season. And there's a key line where you can get a bigger max when you get to 10 years of service. So I would suggest that he opts out and signs like a 3-year deal with an opt out on the last year so that he can time his next free agency with that 10-year mark. You get an option because why not? If you get hurt or something goes wrong, you could always opt in and get that money. And his option is for $28.8 million. But if the cap stays flat, right, if it doesn't go anywhere, then he's eligible for almost, I think, $33 million. So it's still a raise for AD plus the additional years as opposed to just opting in and then going into free agency next year. And then does he sign, again, a shorter deal? You know, it doesn't really make sense. Get the most money you can get locked in and set yourself up for your next contract. So he could do a 5-year deal. Like I said, I think he does a shorter one because that seems to be where the NBA is trending. Guys aren't as focused on the longest deals possible, but maximizing the amount they can make for their career. In the case of someone like KCP, the Lakers have his full rights. They have his full bird rights because he spent 3 years with the team. This is his third season. Remember, he got here the year before LeBron. And so they can pay him up to the max, and he's eligible, he's eligible for the same money that AD is eligible for. Obviously, you're not going to pay him that. But I think the market for him is either the mid-level, which is roughly $10 million, or one of the teams with cap room, of which I only think fundamentally the teams, like, let's see, the Knicks, the Hawks, the Pistons, and the Hornets are like the main teams that have cap room. The Suns can get there, but they have to let go of Dario Saric, which I don't know if they do or don't. If they don't, then they won't have cap room. The Miami Heat could get there, but they would have to let go of Dragic, and some of their cap room is dependent on Olynyk. And then each of these teams mentioned could make trades, or teams that aren't mentioned can make trades to open up space. But by and large, if you make a list of free agents, where is KCP on that list? And Detroit he already did that with Detroit. Didn't work out. I don't think the Knicks should go after him. You never know. I don't think the Hornets should go after him. You can argue the Hawks, and maybe the Hawks make a big offer for KCP. I think about $12 million is more than the mid-level, so there are plenty of teams that might have $10 million to offer. If the Lakers paid him $12 million, you're paying more than that. It could be 11.5, could be 12.5, in that range, so we'll call it 12. That's a reasonable number. And so for KCP to opt out of 8.5, he can get offers for 10 or whatever, and the Lakers can say, okay, we'll keep you and pay $12 million, and that's that. I think that's a reasonable path. But someone like Avery and JaVale, it's a little different, right, Josh? Because Avery didn't play in the bubble. He had a good season. There's not a lot of money out there. Between roughly $5 million for some teams up to $10 million for others. And I don't think he's one of the players who would get any cap room. So he's at $5 million with the Lakers. Can he get $5 million somewhere else? Or is he risking that he'll be paid the minimum, which for him would be about 2.6? So he could lose a couple million dollars roughly. So that's the kind of decision he has to make. Similar question with JaVale, where, yes, he was a productive player, but he didn't play in the playoffs, and they couldn't really play him in the playoffs. So $4.2 million might be better than him risking getting 2.6 for him as well as a minimum. Those are the kind of questions he has to ask. Can he get someone else's money in the range of $5 to $10 million? So Avery and JaVale, I think, are a little bit harder to make the case that they opt out. I feel like KCP is definitely a candidate. I thought he played well in the playoffs. I think he's earned recognition around the league that he's someone who should be a starting guard and can deliver, et cetera. So I think he's probably in the case of getting money. And then we finally get to Rondo as far as these option players. And in the case of Rondo, if he opts out, he could still get about 2.6. His option, which is the minimum. So from any team, he can get 2.6. His option is for 2.7. So he's risking $100,000 that he has to settle for a lesser deal when it's probable that the Lakers want to keep him, that LeBron James would want to keep him, given how valuable he was for the Lakers. And so they have his early bird rights, so they can pay him roughly $10 million as well without dipping into any of their exceptions. They can use their rights. So he can get paid to stay with the Lakers. I'm sure maybe there's someone out there who's willing to pay $4 million, $5 million. I don't think he's a $10 million candidate anywhere else, personally. These are the kind of options that I think the Lakers are looking at. And the challenge is, and this is what I streamed about, if they get up to a certain number and they're too close to that $139 million in team salary by paying KCP a good amount, by paying Rondo, let's say $6 million, and let's say that's $18 million for the two of them combined, or even if you go conservative and say $15 million, still butts up against that hard cap, which could limit them from having that $9.3, $10 million mid-level exception and limit them to just about $5.7 million, almost $6 million. So their flexibility, and this is kind of the main takeaway and really what the stream was about, their flexibility is tied to how much they pay KCP and Rondo, and if Avery opts in, and if McGee opts in. Because if they opt out and the Lakers don't re-sign them, that clears off almost $10 million. So these are the factors. And we're, of course, assuming that AD is back at the max, Josh.
You know, there's a lot of certain factors involved there, obviously, Eric, as far as who opts in, who doesn't, how much money is involved, who what sort of paydays certain guys might be in line for. And I think in Rondo's case, at least, there's consideration as far as who else the Lakers might be eyeing to beef up their roster and beef up their prospects within a conference and against some strong opposition that only figures to get stronger in the next year and however long to come. So let's take a quick break and dive into that consideration and some other factors at play here with the Lakers. You're listening to Hollywood Hoops.
Save time by scheduling your free flu shot at CVS today and get a $5 off $20 shopping pass. Visit cvs.com/flu to get started. No cost flu shots with most insurance. Restrictions apply. Visit cvs.com for details.
Welcome back to Hollywood Hoops. He's Eric Pincus of Basketball Insiders and Bleacher Report. I'm Josh Martin of Close Up 360. You're listening to us wherever you get your podcasts and shows, whether that's Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, Stitcher, Spreaker, lineups.com, or every Wednesday from 9 to 10 a.m. Pacific time on Dash Radio's Nothing But Net channel. So, Eric, in the case of someone like KCP, the Lakers can certainly find other replacements or may have other replacements on hand if someone like, say, Avery Bradley opts back in. You know, he was a starter for them for much of the season prior to the bubble. Maybe it's you bring a J.R. Smith back on a minimum deal, something like that makes a lot of sense. You know, if you're talking JaVale McGee, there are bigs they could go to. They had DeMarcus Cousins on the roster for a time. You know, he was injured the entire season after tearing his ACL prior to the season. So maybe he's someone you look at for some depth, depending on what happens with JaVale and Dwight. There's a lot of different factors here. I think Rondo is an interesting point of consideration here, not just because of the role he played on this year's team, especially in the playoffs, and how valuable he is in that capacity and what he could do going forward, but also on who else the Lakers might target to help them at point guard and maybe in an even bigger capacity. And you wrote about this for Bleacher Report with the headline, NBA execs see LeBron's influence over Lakers leading to a Chris Paul trade. And I guess this has to come with the usual disclaimer, Eric, that you are not the one who writes the headlines. But I just from a bigger perspective here, where do you see Chris Paul fitting into or potentially fitting into the Lakers' offseason plans, and how might their pursuit of him affect their attempts to retain someone like Rondo?
Well, that's an interesting question, Josh. I'll kind of summarize the logic of the article. And if you take from the starting point that LeBron has a significant influence on what the Lakers do, one of the conversations I had with an executive working for an Eastern Conference team was that LeBron is basically like the president of basketball operations of the Lakers. And Rob Plink is like the general manager, even though Rob holds that title of, I think it's vice president of basketball operations, whatever it is, whatever his exact title is. Some teams will do where you'll have like the top executive. Masai Ujiri is a good example of that in Toronto. He has a GM, Bobby Webster, who does the work and makes it all happen. But a lot of the big picture decisions from the basketball point of view are made by the top executive. And certainly Bobby Webster has a significant influence as well. Not to belittle his position, not to belittle Plinko's. But if you make the argument that like LeBron brought over AD, and that's like a direct quote. He said, like, you know, this is why I brought him here. How could you make that claim, LeBron, given that you're a player and the Lakers traded for him? Like, but it's also true. He did, right? Like, AD signed with Clutch with the intention of playing with LeBron in LA, and they made that happen. And that's a big part of why the Lakers were under so much pressure to make the AD trade. And it's why they gave up as much as they did. In terms of the market, the Lakers overpaid for AD based on what other historical trades had been to that point, and based on the fact that there were no other teams that were really in competition at that time. The Celtics were no longer in competition for AD. They were having issues with Irving and had turned into a whole different direction. The Knicks were out. They had offered Porzingis, but that didn't work out, and Porzingis didn't want to be in New Orleans, etc. And you go through all of the history of it. So the Lakers were in a field of one, and yet the Pelicans still milked them for everything that they could. And I'm not belittling what the Lakers did. Obviously, it worked out. Ends justify the means. And what they gave up in retrospect wasn't too much. It wasn't. But the pressure that was there, that existed, and what David Griffin took advantage of was the pressure from LeBron and Clutch on the Lakers to get AD. They didn't have the choice of not making the deal. And that's where they lost their leverage. And Griffin is really familiar with this dynamic because he was the general manager of the Cleveland Cavaliers and had to deal with LeBron firsthand and Rich Paul firsthand. And I'm not talking negatively about anybody here. I don't think anyone's at fault. I don't think anybody is doing anything nefarious. I don't like it when people say, oh, like the Clutch is like the mafia, because that's, to me, that's insulting. And some of those takes to me taste a little, touching on a little bit of racism, just a little bit.
It's a smidge.
Just a smidge. Right.
And look, the end, whatever you feel about that, if you're the Lakers, the ends justify the means because they won a championship as a result of these machinations.
Right. 100%. So to get back to, you know, your question and what you're asking is like Chris Paul, how does he fit into that? And so if we look at like if LeBron is in charge, what did he learn from the playoffs on this version of the Lakers, right? Like, how did they win, Josh? How did they win this title? Obviously, AD and LeBron did their part, but after those two, what really broke it open and made it work, at least by your opinion?
I mean, Rondo obviously was a big part of that, coming in as that secondary playmaker, or really a guy who could lead the second unit whenever LeBron had to sit, someone who could get the ball, Anthony Davis. And I think the other factor was just having a roster full of players who could fill different roles, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we think about, you know, the ideal of the NBA today is you have a roster of, you know, 13, 15 players, however many players, and everybody can do a little bit of everything and everybody's interchangeable. But the Lakers really showed that you can have success, especially in the playoffs, with specialists, right? You have guys who are shooters, guys who are hustling defenders on the perimeter. You have a guy like Dwight who you can kind of break the glass in case of an emergency and throw him out there against big guys. You had Alex Caruso starting game 6 in the finals because of the speed and aggression he gave them on the defensive end and just his overall hustle. And so I think those two things might be at odds with the pursuit of someone like a Chris Paul, right? Where, yes, you want that playmaker to back up LeBron so LeBron doesn't have to be the primary playmaker all the time. You don't wear him down. You don't rely on him entirely, because that's where LeBron's teams have faltered over the course of his career, is that whenever he comes off the floor, typically they're like a fish out of water, basically. But by the same token, if you're going after someone like a Chris Paul, just by virtue of his salary and how you go about acquiring him, you're going to have to sacrifice a significant amount of that depth, those options, those almost baseball-like options of different specialists you can pull from to get through a situation. So it's an interesting balance, interesting confluence of factors that might lead the Lakers or not lead the Lakers to pursue someone like Chris Paul. But that number one point really on the Lakers' success in the playoffs was having Rondo come in to supercharge things. And if Rajon Rondo at his age can get that job done, even on an inconsistent basis, how much better could the Lakers be with someone like Chris Paul, who, though he is certainly up there in ages and he's in as good a shape really as he's ever been in a lot of ways, and is certainly much more consistent than Rondo on both ends of the floor.
Right. And you kind of hit where I was hoping you would go on that. So yes, there's the depth issue, right? And versatility of play. Losing certain pieces doesn't mean those pieces couldn't be replaced. For instance, if you lose Avery Bradley, you can replace an Avery Bradley. In fact, Avery Bradley wasn't even there to be replaced. I mean, he wasn't a part of the equation. JaVale McGee was not playable for the most of the playoffs based on the way that the Lakers play. So right off the bat, we're talking about two players. And then Quinn Cook did not play. He's not a good enough defender and doesn't fit the model of how the Lakers play. So now you've got three players that don't, if you lost them, do not take away from the depth. Now, if you replace McGee, again, we're talking from the perspective of LeBron as president of basketball operations. Well, there are two big men on the Clutch brand that are free agents this summer, Tristan Thompson and Nerlens Noel. So if you look at it from the perspective that LeBron is confident that if needed, he can bring over one of those two guys or both of those guys, right, then they can fill the JaVale spot. You might be able to upgrade in Tristan Thompson, who's a better rebounder and is a more physical player and does have a little bit more offense in certain ways, but might be certainly someone who's played with LeBron and won with LeBron. Noel is a defender, shot blocker, not really an offensive player, equivalent more or less to JaVale. JaVale can be replaced by one of those two players, and some could argue that Tristan Thompson would be an upgrade. Avery didn't play, and here's another aspect, Josh. And this isn't as much about Chris Paul as it is, how are the Lakers, if Avery comes back and if Rondo comes back, how is it going to work as far as minutes? And, you know, I did a tally of the minutes, and they basically have, like, if you look at the point guard and shooting guard positions, the one and the two, never mind that LeBron plays point guard on offense, but positionally they play KCP or Avery as the starting point, which is really a defensive role. But you also have Alex Caruso, Danny Green, and then you're trying to find a spot for Talen Horton Tucker, right, who played well in the brief minutes he got. He's on Clutch. So being on Clutch, and if we're looking at LeBron's point of view, developing him becomes more of a priority, and he showed that he can do things. He's someone who should earn minutes in his second year as part of his natural development. First year in the G League, second year, a small bench role, and then if he continues to grow, by third year, a top eight rotation player. That would be the goal. And then eventually a starter. If you're Clutch, that would be the career arc of a second round pick like that. And then Rondo, right? Like, where are all the minutes? They can't possibly play all those players. And you say, well, it gives you redundancy for injury. Sure. And you don't have to rely too heavily on Rondo. Sure. But there's a point where if these guys are playing 10 minutes a game or not playing at all, that's not really a productive scenario either, and you're not getting the most out of these players. So if you're losing the depth of Avery Bradley, it's almost addition by subtraction. Now, forget not even talking about Chris Paul, but if Avery left, opted out, and didn't return, the Lakers don't necessarily need to replace him because they have already too many bodies at those positions. And it also means to me that there's no room for, like, let's say they wanted a free agent point guard, TJ Augustine, who's a better scorer and can run the pick and roll well, but not a good defender. Like, where's the room for that in a rotation? And the answer is there isn't. That's without Avery. You're still going to need KCP, Rondo, THT, Caruso, and Green to play those minutes. So to me, there's not even room for adding one without additional subtraction. So to kind of tackle the concerns about loss of depth, at the one and the two, the Lakers have too much depth right now. They actually don't have any room for anybody to join the team, let alone keeping Dion Waiters. If they keep him, where would he possibly play? He didn't play in the playoffs because there wasn't even any room. They played J.R. Smith behind Danny Green a little bit when there was some foul trouble. But like losing J.R. Smith, again, doesn't register on the radar. So, Josh, there's still more we got to dig into here. I don't know if we touched on everything. I'm just trying to make the argument. I feel like you made great points, and I think they support the argument towards Chris Paul in a lot of ways. But I think there's more to the story and arguments against as well.
Yeah, exactly. We got to touch on what the actual prospective package would be for Chris Paul, which we danced around quite nicely there in that segment. So we'll get into the nuts and bolts of it a little bit more right after this break. You're listening to Hollywood Hoops.
Have you been wanting to lose weight and get healthy? Now's the perfect time to start Nutrisystem. Enjoy your favorite foods made healthier, delivered free to your door. Right now, you can get Uniquely Yours Ultimate, our most complete foolproof plan at an amazing price. Order today and save 50%, plus get an extra $40 off. Go to Nutrisystem.com/save and discover what millions of people already know. Nutrisystem works. Limitations apply. See website for full offer details.
Welcome back to Hollywood Hoops. He's Eric Pincus of Basketball Insiders and Bleacher Report. I'm Josh Martin of Close Up 360. You're listening to us wherever you get your podcasts and shows, whether that's Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, Stitcher, Spreaker, lineups.com, or every Wednesday from 9 to 10 a.m. Pacific time on Dash Radio's Nothing But Net channel. So, Eric, we kind of came into this discussion of Chris Paul to the Lakers backwards, I guess. Kind of, I brought up the notion of should the Lakers be worried about sacrificing depth to get someone like Chris Paul? And of course, that's without having actually discussed what it would take for the Lakers to potentially get Chris Paul or someone of his ilk on the roster alongside LeBron James and Anthony Davis. So what, in your mind, would a package for Chris Paul look like if the Lakers were to try to swing a trade for someone of his salary and his talent with the Oklahoma City Thunder?
Well, the starting point would be Avery and JaVale opting in. And if they opt out, that's problematic. Although sign-and-trade transactions could happen, but they have to be willing to be an active participant and to sign-and-trade with the Thunder, and maybe that's not what they would want. So you lose your agency if you're the Lakers if they opt out. The math on someone like Chris Paul, who is making a massive salary, which I know that a lot of Laker fans are afraid of, just flat out. You know, I'll argue that it is impactful, but not as impactful as you might think. He makes $41.3 million next season. Chris does, and then has an option the year after, 44.2. So we're talking about owed $86 million, roughly, just under. That's a lot for a player that age, for a player who does have an injury history. No question, right? But when we start getting into really the issue is, like, what are you giving up? What's the opportunity cost? So we said that if JaVale is replaceable by Tristan Thompson or Nerlens Noel, and, of course, I'll throw out there that there's still the possibility of bringing in DeMarcus Cousins based on his relationship with the Lakers, with LeBron, but most notably with Anthony Davis, that DeMarcus Cousins is certainly a possible. And given his situation, he may not be even more than the minimum at this point, given all of his injury history. So, you know, things to at least consider. And then in the case of Avery, the argument is that there's no room for him if he stays and you don't get Chris Paul. There's no room for somebody. And they've already won without Avery. And if you're bringing in Chris Paul, he's not as, you know, I would say that is Avery really a better defender than Chris Paul? Maybe. I don't know that. I know that Chris Paul is one of the better position defenders at the point. I mean, he's elite at playing defense, and he's, you know, a much, much better offensive player than Avery Bradley. It's not even going to compare. You know, we're not apples to oranges. It's not even the same thing. Chris Paul is dramatically better than Avery Bradley and is also historically a very, very good defender, even against bigger players. And you just can't dribble the ball. Like, there's somewhere there's footage of Kobe Bryant. I think it was on Detail. Before he passed, he talked about how you don't want to dribble around Chris Paul because he's a thief and he's going to take the ball.
And there is something to be said there as far as the effort that Chris Paul could expend more regularly on the defensive end if he doesn't have to carry quite the same load on the offensive end on the Lakers team.
It would be a vacation, Josh, for Chris Paul.
Yeah, for sure. And from a health perspective, you know, he played 70 of 72 regular season games with OKC this year, played obviously very well in their playoff series against Houston. And it's worth considering that, yes, he does have a long history of injuries and surgeries and whatnot. But, you know, having been around him and having had a chance, fortunately, to speak with him during this past season, at least I know that he feels like he's in the best shape he's ever been in part because he changed his diet. He's vegan now. Essentially, he's a big endorser of Beyond Meat and Beyond Burgers and all that. I know that that's really helped him to get in better physical shape, not just in terms of losing weight, but keeping down inflammation so that he's not in pain, especially in his knees after he's played for an extended period of time. So, yes, he has a history, and that's worth being concerned about if you're the Lakers. But I think you also have to factor in that the Chris Paul of today, from a physical perspective, is very different from the Chris Paul that we've seen go down at inopportune moments throughout his career.
Well, it's always going to be a risk, flat out, because that's life, right? Like, risk is life. But Rondo has a long injury history as well. I mean, he's somebody who's been hurt all year. He breaks his hand, it seems like, twice a year. I mean, a finger or hand. And it's just, he's got huge hands. Like, that's one, he has like Kawhi type hands. And whatever, they're vulnerable. So that's kind of goes to the heart of the matter and really to the answer that you gave, Josh, last segment as to like what stood out for the Lakers as to why it worked, right? It worked because they didn't have to go through LeBron. How many times did you see, and this is for the, you know, for the listeners, kind of rhetorical question, how many times did you see LeBron at the top of the key with the ball in his hand, with no player movement, with three or four defenders ready to go, one on AD, and someone in position to help on AD if he got the ball, and LeBron has nowhere to go as far as driving. And so there were some games where, yes, he just put his head down and drove into traffic and scored on three or four defenders. Is that the diet of success for LeBron and for the Lakers, especially from his point of view, because no one on the earth knows what that feels like more than LeBron, to drive into an entire defensive team, take that kind of physical punishment. And LeBron is not young, and there's a point where it would be nice if he didn't have to deal with that. You know, from his point of view, he probably would like to at some point not have to do that. And so what the result would be, LeBron would sometimes drive, and sometimes you'd see these step back threes that were bad shots, and he shot a low percentage. Now, a couple of games he got super hot and made those. But from a basketball point of view, and LeBron is beyond elite with listen to him after a post game where he'll break down what happened and he'll count down like the last 10 plays in order and have it exactly right as to what happened. It's like he's a savant. I guess that's the right word, right? So you don't think he knows that those are not the ideal plays and that he should, a step back three is not ideal? He knows this, right? It's just that there's no space. And we saw in the beginning of the playoffs, during different series, he turned to Vogel and said there's no space, all that. And so part of the solution for the Lakers, given that they didn't have great shooting, although it was better than anticipated by opponents and pundits, was that Rondo took off the pressure, where LeBron played off the ball in key moments. Point is that we're going to say Chris Paul is injury prone. Well, Rondo's injury prone, and none of the other players on this team can fill that role. Caruso can't fill that role of getting AD easy shots. And the other point you made, Josh, which is 100% on, the LeBron is used to his team for the most part hemorrhaging when he's off the floor. That didn't happen with Rondo and AD. And again, it's, you're putting a lot on Rondo, and he's showed that he could do it, and that's great, and maybe he can duplicate that, and bringing him back is absolutely imperative. But there's no one else who can do that, so you're going to count on that. Being that if this is the most important thing outside of AD and LeBron, and you say the versatility was the next thing, well, they can replace the versatility, right? Like, if you need shooting, Kyle Korver's a free agent, even though he's older. if you need a replacement for Kyle Kuzma, Josh, because we're going to start to get to the concreteness of this. If you need a flat-out scorer off your bench, I know not a lot of Laker fans are going to love this. Some might, you know, the Carmelo Anthony is available. And, you know, it's banana boat time. I mean, if you need to replace what Kuzma does, which is primarily just score off the bench, and yes, he improved defensively in some areas. He was better against Houston defensively. He was better against Portland defensively. He was terrible against Denver defensively. And there were stretches where he was good on Jimmy and stretches where he was bad on Jimmy defensively. It was a mixed bag against Jimmy, right? So you put all that together, if you're losing Kuzma, if you're losing Avery Bradley, JaVale McGee, Quinn Cook, and the Lakers put in their number 28, their pick in this draft. It has to be after. You have to sign the player, wait 30 days, which, you know, we don't have to get into the technicalities of it, but it's possible, right? The other player that you have to include, which does address, you know, some of what you said, you know, is they are losing depth, is Danny Green. They would have to lose Danny Green in that. And that does change the equation a little bit because you do lose a key defender and a key shooter. Even though he missed that one big shot, he was an important part of this. So I can't deny that you do lose some depth. But the Lakers would have an exception. And let's say that you could replace Danny Green with, say, Mo Harkless. Clipper fans would be familiar with Mo Harkless. He's somebody who can defend 1 through 5 and is a good, great teammate, happy to do whatever is asked of him, can start, can come off the bench. Not a great shooter, has a history of making some big shots in the playoffs with Portland and whatnot. You can argue that if you bring in Cousins or Tristan Thompson, or if you bring in Melo to replace Kuzma, and you bring in Korver as a shooter, and you bring in Harkless, to me, a big defender is absolutely mandatory. Someone has to come in as a big defender. But you bring in Chris Paul to replace Avery Bradley, like, as it is, we've already talked about the overload in the backcourt. Well, you take out Danny Green's minutes and you give those to KCP as the starter, and you have Rondo backing up Chris Paul, and both those guys can share that minutes. There's never a point where the Lakers don't have a secondary playmaker on the floor. And when you're in games where you don't need all that and you're up and you're fine, you develop THT, and you have Caruso backing up Chris Paul, and you have Korver as a shooter off the bench behind LeBron at the three, and you have Harkless as a backup 3-4 to play defense, who can also defend smaller players or bigger players. You wouldn't want him on a Jokic, but you would want him on a small ball center. And you have Tristan Thompson or Dwight, and you still can bring back Markieff as well. To me, I feel like the versatility is there. If anything, it's increased. Yes, you're smaller going with Chris Paul, but is Chris Paul that much smaller than Avery Bradley? Avery Bradley's not very tall either. Yes, there's a difference. I mean, the Lakers would get a little bit smaller, certainly because he didn't play and KCP's bigger. So you say, well, they're smaller in the playoffs. But I would argue that if healthy, that Chris Paul is an absolute upgrade across the board, takes away that uncertainty and gives LeBron that guy coupled with Rondo for 48 minutes a game if you need it. So there's never that moment. Now you also have a third scorer, which I don't think is proven is the most important thing. But any scoring you lose from Kuzma, you're going to get back with Chris Paul at that position. And then you can bring in another scorer like a Melo or whatever. So, you know, I said a lot there, Josh. I want to get your thoughts on it, although we may have to get them after the break.
Yeah, I think it makes a lot of sense overall, especially in a situation where you don't want to wear out Chris Paul and you know that Rondo sort of works better in spurts. And you're looking at going into something close to a full-length season, if not an absolute full-length season. We'll see what it is, ultimately. So they're going to need that sort of point guard play over the course of it. And I think if you had cut off the season at the shutdown and nothing had happened after that, I would imagine that Laker fans would not have been too keen to bring Rondo back. We've seen that if Rondo is in a very prescribed role, if you don't have to run him out there for tons of minutes, and you're really focused on just getting to the finish line, I think he can be very valuable for them. So maybe he becomes almost a situational player on a Lakers team that has Chris Paul, and you can play Rondo here and there during the regular season, but really what you want him for is the playoffs. And so when you get to the playoffs, you can kind of put him into full go mode, have him get ready and have his play that playoff Rondo basketball that we've seen from him. And you can make up the rest all the way around. So I think that would make a lot of sense. It would allow the Lakers to really compete against the more guard-oriented teams in the league, like, say, the Golden State Warriors, who figure to be back in the mix next season. It would still have the versatility to some extent to deal with, you know, other teams like the Nuggets, like the Clippers, the Houston Rockets, you know, whoever else comes along, even the Dallas Mavericks to some extent, while still allowing them to have the playmaking they need to be a really good team for 48 minutes and not just the 35 to 40 that LeBron is on the floor. So I think there's a lot that I think the Lakers take interest in there. I wonder whether the Thunder would be so inclined to move on that. I think there's some more considerations there. Do they want to stay competitive? Does their ownership want to stay competitive? And are they really that determined to move off of Chris Paul's contract that maybe they would take back a package that, you know, there's some decent pieces in there. Like Kyle Kuzma seems like at least a decent role player. He's won a championship now. You get a draft pick or two potentially out of that if you're OKC, but it's nothing that's going to bowl you over. But if you have a guy like Chris Paul who is 35 and is making the kind of money that he's making, you're going to have to, if you're trying to move him, you're going to have to make some sacrifice in terms of what you're actually going to get back. So, yeah, there's a lot of considerations there. But I think ultimately, if the Lakers can hit all those notes in the right way and at the right time with the right players, then they could find themselves with an even stronger team than the one that just helped them get to their 17th championship. It's a compelling picture, certainly, but there's still some more details and considerations for us to sort through. We'll do that right after this break. You're listening to Hollywood Hoops.
CVS is your one-stop shop for immunity support and more. This week, select CVS Health and Zicam products are buy one, get one 50% off. Visit CVS or CVS.com today. Restrictions apply. See CVS.com/weeklyad for details.
Welcome back to Hollywood Hoops. He's Eric Pincus of Basketball Insiders and Bleacher Report. I'm Josh Martin of Close Up 360. So, Eric, we talked about why the Lakers would want to do a deal for Chris Paul. And I kind of started to get into why maybe the Thunder would or wouldn't want to pull the trigger on a package that would get them back Al Kuzma, Danny Green, potentially Quinn Cook, Avery Bradley, JaVale McGee, and let's say the Lakers' number 28 pick in the draft, which is supposed to happen on November 18th. If you're the Thunder, you know, what are the considerations that you're looking at if you're Sam Presti? Would you be inclined to turn down that deal and see if you can get something more for Chris Paul? Are you satisfied with keeping him around for two more years?
This is obviously complex, and there's no like, oh yeah, the Thunder do this, of course. We just went from a very Lakers perspective. But from the Thunder perspective, they just made the playoffs, but they have to make decisions on Danilo Gallinari. Do they retain him? And he's looking for probably about $15 million a year, more if he can get it, and might be able to get that from Detroit because of the connection with his former agent. Arntellum runs the Pistons, is the top guy, even though he's not the GM anymore. He's the top, you know, like the consultant, or not even the consultant. He's the advisor to the owner. And he makes a lot of their decisions.
He's the consigliere.
Yeah. And his son is Michael Tellum. And his son is Danilo's agent. So I could see the Pistons going short-term with Danilo to get his son a commission to take care of a client. And that might be a temporary fix because, to me, the Pistons are probably like a long-term rebuild and you still need to have players who can play and score. So let's say Danilo goes to the Pistons, and he might not. He might go somewhere else. But I don't think that the Thunder are ready to reinvest in him, not at $15 million. And I could be wrong, but I don't think so. Adams is in the last year of his deal, and Schroeder is in the last year of his deal. If you say, like, well, who are their young players that matter for their future? Shea, 100%. Obviously, Dort, who is really good. And Baisley is a player to develop. We're not talking about a deep roster of young players, mostly because this was a team that was trying to be full on in contention and win and sacrificed the future for now. And then when they traded Russell Westbrook and Paul George, they just completely hit the mother lode in future consideration. They have more picks than anybody. They're in a great future position, and I struggle to see them tying up future money. But I do think this is a team that is at a place where they need to have some time to reset and start to reload. And if there's ever a good time to do it, it's this year where there are no fans in seats, or at least initially, or it's questionable of how important it is. There's always the battle of, like, you need to have attendance. You don't want to have a terrible team. Tanking is unpleasant, and you don't want to lose the local fan revenue. You want to sell out your building as much as possible. And this may be the perfect opportunity, the perfect time to not worry about that factor. So I think there will be several teams that are going to be more prone to tanking this year than in the past, because they're probably not going to lose the revenue that they would normally lose, because that may be gone until we at least know how the world is going to shape out and how the NBA is going to fit this all together. So certainly a lot of questions, but I will say, I don't want to spend too much more time on this, running out of time, that they don't have anything close to a power forward prospect. And Kuzma would immediately be their best player at that position, especially if Gallinari is not back. They get a bunch of veterans that they can then retrade. So you might be able to get something for Avery and McGee. Not a lot, but second round picks, or maybe some other young prospects like Isaiah Roby types, who are maybe not necessarily, or Abdel Nader, guys who are not necessarily important for some other team, but maybe their scouting department has put some value on some players that they think will be the next Lugans Dort, et cetera, et cetera. So you can make the argument that going with a rebuild the Lakers way, knocking off Chris Paul's $44 million off their books for the next year and breaking Chris's down into smaller components, which they then trade out, would be absolutely the way to go. The other point there would be is that, well, what if the Bucks want to make a run at Chris Paul to try to keep Giannis? There's no guarantee that they would want an older player like Chris, and it's expensive to get him. And Eric Bledsoe would have to be involved, and he has a multi-year deal. Lakers deals are friendly, but maybe there's something there. I don't know. The Knicks are always a team. Again, we made the logic of Gallinari to the Pistons. Same logic. Chris Paul's former agent is with the Knicks, Leon Rose, and maybe they make a run for him. I would not advise the Knicks to do so. Doesn't mean they won't. That's a team that's always a wild card. We don't have Vlade anymore to make to blame for wild card moves, but we'll stick with the Knicks. So put that all together, and I think it's somewhat feasible. I don't think it's likely, but it's arguable. From the Lakers' point of view, there's an opportunity cost. I think Kuzma is their one young asset. If they're not trading away Caruso, who LeBron is really high on and is very valuable, the only real piece they have to offer is Kuzma, and he's extension eligible. And so this may be the opportune time to get him before that money is worked out, because if you re-sign him for too much, he's not worth it, or maybe he doesn't re-sign. If they trade him now, it's vital that they get that long-term Rondo replacement. It's the third piece for LeBron and AD that is most important is not necessarily a third scorer. We just saw that they don't need a third scorer, but that secondary initiator, that player in that Rondo role, is far more important than what someone like Kyle Kuzma can do as an additional scorer. That you can fill in with shooters and scorers and defenders. You can do that, but that true initiator who could truly hold it down when LeBron is off and supplement LeBron so that he doesn't have to drive into a three or four man double team, and you have to really worry about what Chris Paul is going to do with AD before you worry about LeBron. That to me is a formula for absolute success, and it's a major upgrade over Rondo in talent, although you keep Rondo too and you're doubling up on that, and you are losing the opportunity cost of getting, maybe they can find someone else like Chris Paul who's cheaper for Kuzma, maybe Spencer Dinwiddie, or I don't think there's any chance that someone like Victor Oladipo for that kind of money, personally. And he's not really even exactly what we're describing, but certainly a good player. If you say you can get Dinwiddie for Kuzma and one other player, you can certainly make that argument. I'm of the opinion that they can't, and if they can't get a good young player who can last for the next 3 or 4 years, if you're in a win now, I think Chris Paul is going to last at this level for the next 2 years. And so you're in a great position. You're giving up Kuzma. That's the most dangerous piece that you're giving up. I don't think it's out of bounds, Josh. I don't think it's perfect, but it's not out of bounds.
Few things are perfect in this life, even the NBA. Even if you're the Lakers, There's one more consideration for the Lakers in terms of their roster and their salary cap situation, and that's with Luol Deng. There was a report from Shams Charania of The Athletic recently that the Lakers are looking to have Luol Deng's salary removed from their books due to a career-ending injury. He retired last October. What does that mean for the Lakers, I guess? And I suppose you'll get into this in a different format soon enough here, Eric.
That's true. I am going to stream later today. This is on Tuesday. So if you're listening on Dash Radio's Nothing But Net channel, you can find it on my YouTube channel. Again, just find it on my Twitter feed, which is Eric Pincus, E-R-I-C-P-I-N-C-U-S. It'll be pinned to it. And I'll go over the mathematics and legality and the likelihood of the Lakers finding a way to get out of the $5 million that they have on the books for Luol Deng, not just this year, but next year as well. I think it's a long shot. I can make an argument as to why it could happen. The big question is that Deng went on to play 22 games with the Timberwolves the next year. So how could they claim it's a career-ending injury when he played the next season? And we'll talk about the literal rule and the spirit of the rule and the interpretation and try to see, do the Lakers have a case? And is it going to be a yes or a no? We can't answer that, but we can at least make the argument. So I'm going to get into that into detail. We'll look at the CBA and try to make sense of it, Josh. That'll be on my YouTube stream.
All right. Well, everyone, be sure to check out Eric's YouTube stream. Hit him up on social media at Eric Pincus, E-R-I-C-P-I-N-C-U-S. I'm Josh Martin. Hit me up on social media at Josh Martin NBA. Find Close Up 360 at closeup360.com. That's C-L-O-S-E-U-P and the number 360.com. On social at closeup360 and on YouTube at youtube.com/CU360. Together, Eric and I are Hollywood Hoops. Listen to us wherever you get your podcasts and shows, whether that's Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, Stitcher, Spreaker, lineups.com, or every Wednesday from 9 to 10 a.m. Pacific Time on Dash Radio's Nothing But Net channel. And hit us up on social media at Hollywood_Hoops and on Facebook at facebook.com/HollywoodHoopsPod. And we'll be back with you again next week with another edition of Hollywood Hoops.
Halloween is just around the corner and DFW Security has a spooky good deal for you. It's a trick-or-treat pick four special. Get DFW Security's incredible smart hub app and security system and you get to pick any four smart devices or cameras. Mix and match automation, security, and video like smart locks, thermostats, and garage doors, indoor and outdoor cameras, even doorbell cameras. Whatever you choose, treat yourself to this trick-or-treat special. Call 888-507-2344 or go to dfwsecurity.com.
No matter where you are in your wellness journey, immune support is crucial. That's why you need quality immune support that you can trust. Nature's Way Sambucus is the elderberry brand that you can count on to provide quality, traditional immune support. We pick our elderberries at their peak to deliver an elderberry extract rather than a juicer or powder, so you know you're getting the best of what nature has to offer. Find your way to well with quality immune support from Nature's Way Sambucus. This statement has not been evaluated by the Food and Drug Administration. This product is not intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent any disease.